Thank you. Everybody say, Jesus,
Jesus,
take my life.
Take my life.
Amen.
Wonderful.
Father, again, we just give you praise. We give you glory. We thank you for being so kind and so good and so patient. We just ask you to bless each and every one that's here. And we give you all the praise in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. You may be seated. Didn't the worship team do a good job? Give them a hand. Good to have you all with us this morning. So we do reverence in God's house, right? That means you put away your cell phones, take off your hats.
Maybe even silence them. Yeah.
Get your feet off the furniture. Look out, preacher. It's God's house. It's not a gymnasium. Amen. And you're in my church, so you will respect it. And we're going to do something this morning because my big brother's in a lot of pain. And a lot of you don't know him, but he's thrown his back out this last week. And he's crookeder than a snake. So we're going to have him come up here. We're going to pray for him right now because there's no point in him just staying in misery, right? All right. If you want to stand up with me, if you would. Let's go to church. Let's pray for this young man. He's too young to be having all these issues.
Amen.
Father, we just ask you to minister to Darian right now, Lord. Through the power of your Holy Spirit. Just let the sweet balm of Gilead run up and down his spine right now. Just touch him, Lord. Do what the chiropractors can't do. The doctors don't even know what to do. Just touch him and minister and relax these muscles, Lord. Through the power of your Holy Spirit, sweet balm of Gilead, just rise up within him. Touch him and minister to him right now. In the name of Jesus. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. Well, the Lord is good. Amen.
Amen.
Well, we got a lot of things going on, and one is Wednesday night. And I want to tell you that we had a great Wednesday night last week, and those of you that are here appreciate that. But we had two people accept the Lord last Wednesday night. Young lady who came up in the midst of the program and just said, "You've touched me with your songs, and I want to know Jesus." And Amen. So the Lord is good. And we had another gentleman also. So it's good. All right. Brother Ralph, you got some words of wisdom for us?
Amen. Okay, you got to be patient the way I read. And the Father who sent me, he has bore witness of me. To have never heard his voice at any time, not seen his form, and you do not have his word abiding in you, for you do not believe him whom he sent. You search the scriptures because you think that in them you have eternal life, and it is those that bear witness of me, and you are unwilling to come to me that you might have life. I do not receive glory from man, but I know you that you do not have the love of God in you, in your name, and you do not receive me. If any shall come in his own name, you will receive him. How can you believe what you receive glory, the glory that is from the one and only God.
Amen.
That was really hard for me. Okay, you know, I was going to say, you know, a lot of people, they claim to be Christians. Oh, this and this and that and this. So I talk to a lot of people. I just don't talk here. I talk when I'm out there. I'm sharing the gospel with everybody. Anybody wants to listen to me, I'll share the gospel. And a lot of people, they tell me their problems, what's going on, and I try to show them This is what the Lord says. But they don't want to listen to that. They don't want to listen. And I'm telling you, they claim to be Christians. And they say, well, you don't understand. I said, it's not me that don't understand. It's God that you're arguing with. You're not arguing with me. You're arguing with God's word. If God said to do it, you do it.
Amen.
You don't argue. You don't argue with it. You know, it's just, it breaks my heart to see people that I love that don't agree with God. You have to agree to everything that God says. And you know, I was working in the yard yesterday. I cut my hands all up. I was working in the yard yesterday, and I talked to God all day. And I was telling, you know, the Lord and it came to me when God says, pick up your cross and follow me. A lot of people hear that, and they think they pick up their cross, but are they really following God? When God says to pick up your cross, that's for every single thing you do. Amen. Follow me. Do what I tell you. This is the way to go, not that way.
Amen.
Hear my words. We got to hear God's word. God has an answer for everything that we got trouble on this earth. God has the answer. But you know what it is? We don't want to hear it.
Yeah.
We don't want to hear the truth. We'd rather hear a lie. Our TV or something. We don't want to hear God's word. We don't want to hear it. I get so much flack for me saying God's word. And I don't care what they do to me. And the day, like last week, I remember the pastor saying, it's really going to get hard on the Christians. I'm telling you right now, if there's two guys there with a gun, they said, if you say God's name, I'm going to shoot you. That'd be the last time you see me on earth, because hey, I'm going to let him shoot me. And you know, that's the way I feel. When I picked up the cross, I meant, I'm going to follow you, Lord. I'm going to do what you tell me to do. I don't care what happens or who's mad at me. I'm going to follow you, Lord, because I love you and I know you're right. He's the creator of everything. What fools are we? We're not going to follow God's word. I just don't grasp it. But I know I'm going to follow God's word. So let's say a prayer. Lord, I just thank you, Lord, for another day, Lord. And I prayed and I prayed, Lord, because I didn't know how to read or nothing, Lord. I prayed for wisdom. And I'm telling you right now, Lord, and you know it because you gave it to me. You have gave me a lot of wisdom about your word, Lord. And everything that you say in that Bible is true, Lord. And there's so much stuff that is so great in that Bible, Lord, because you taught me how to read, to understand, because you knew my heart. I really meant it, Lord, that I wanted the wisdom of you have, Lord, and you gave it to me. So thank you, my Lord, in Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
And now Ralph will take the offering. Still to pray for a lot of people. We're going to remember Crystal in prayer.
Can I have a praise?
Yes.
My son in Minnesota, who lost his life a couple weeks ago, that you guys have been praying for.
Tyson.
He is doing as well as you can. But the absolute praise is my youngest son has been in Syria. Well, out of the blue, they flew him home last night.
Oh. Yeah. Wow.
Amen. Literally out of the blue, huh?
Literally.
Well, praise the Lord. We're going to remember Tyson in prayer anyway. Continue to remember him in prayer. And Wade, Denise, and C is here today. We want to remember him in prayer. Crystal, want to remember her in prayer. Had an operation. And John McClure, want to remember him in prayer. Lorraine, again, still needs our prayer. When some of us got to see her last week, and she was back in the hospital again, where there was some procedures. We want to remember her. Margaret, down there, her mother passed away. And this weekend, Liz McKay, we're going to be having their services at 11:30. And so if you would like to come, that's part of Don Jeffries' friend. So we're going to have those services on Saturday at 11:30. And we want to remember Donna and her daughter in prayer. And just a lot. Their brother's family. And Tom, who lost his boy just a few weeks back, so a couple of months back now. So we remember him in prayer. So a lot to pray for, amen?
Amen.
All right, and say nothing about our country, our world, that could send a little prayer. How many think America could use a little prayer?
Amen.
And maybe the world could use a little Jesus, huh?
Amen.
Father, again, we just love you so much. We give you praise, we give you glory, and we thank you for being so good and so kind. And we know you're all powerful. To us, this list just blows our mind, but I know your list is a lot longer than ours. In fact, you don't even know, you don't even have a list because you just know. And Lord, we just give you all the praise and all the glory. We ask you to minister to our loved ones and to our family, to our country, to our nation, and to the world. May all this that's going on do nothing more than start a revival.
Yes.
Amen. Lord, that would be just so great. Light a fire in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
You may be seated, and Naretta is going to come do a special for us now.
Before I sing, I'd like to invite Gloria up to the stage real quick. Gloria, come on. She's always like the most humblest.
Give her a mic.
No. Oh, yeah. No, I wouldn't do that because I know I would be in trouble. If any of you, October is Pastor Appreciation Month, and I don't know, Pastor, I appreciate more.
Yeah.
Oh, yes. So, thank you so much. Thank you. And they're a team. They're a team. They're a team.
They are.
I don't know how they can do it without each other.
My woman.
Beautiful couple here. Anyways, we want you to know how much we appreciate you.
Well, thank you.
Yes.
This is for you.
You're going fishing.
And this is for you. And if anybody didn't get to give a love gift, you can come up and still put it in there.
I'm just trying to see if there's any fishing.
No. You can open it if you want to, but like I said, if anybody didn't get a chance to give a love gift, you can come up and give it right now.
All right. I like this part better. Oh, thank you. All right, a pot full of money. I got a good catch.
That's how it works, huh?
She doesn't give me an allowance. I know where she hides it, too, so.
That is funny.
Thank you. Thank you all. Yes, I just couldn't imagine. I actually just got back from Indiana. I had the best vacation ever. So relaxing and spirit-filled, and got a chance to see my mom, my mama, and my grandkids back there, and a lot of good friends from the church that I had met before. And so my mom kept insisting that I sing, of course, you know. And I said, yes, I would. And then I told them on Sunday morning, I said, I always have to talk before I sing because it just calms me down, I guess. It's just my thing. Anyway, so I told him, you don't mind? And he said, no. So I wrote out and I got to church on Sunday and I said, okay, I am a Sunday school teacher, and the Sunday school teacher came out at me. And he said, if it's okay, it's okay. Just go for it. But then, you know, usually on Mondays, I always have church with pastor because I'm usually in the back with the kids. But Monday, I was in the air coming home. So Tuesday, I had church. And I got so excited because, okay. So can you hear me better? Oh, yes. Wow.
Wow, yeah.
What a big difference. Wow. Okay.
Yeah.
So I got so excited because a lot of times when I'm teaching, you know, I always ask the Holy Spirit, please be giving me the right things to do with my kids to reach them and to show them your love, you know. And I started writing out this, and when I seen my church service, I felt like confirmation that I am on the right page. And I had to share it with you guys because I honestly got a chance to introduce myself as my mom's daughter and thank them because they were so good to me. But then I read, I love being a teacher and I love being on the worship team. And I actually don't know which gift I appreciate more because I love my kids. I love my kids. You are all so beautiful and I'm so proud of each and every one of you. And so then I started telling them about how it was about 4 months ago, we were doing an in-depth study of Ephesians 6. And so I tried to narrow it down on the full armor of God. But I had taught the kids in the class that before they step out into their world, school, whether it be school with family, in their surrounding, their world, that they were to put on the full armor of God. And so while they put on their pants, they would put on the belt of truth and remember the truth that day that they put it on. And who was the truth?
God.
Jesus, right? Okay. He is the way, the truth, and the life. John 14:6.
Yes.
It's also a reminder to us to always tell the truth and stand for the truth. And as you put on your shirt, you also put on your breastplate of righteousness. Righteousness means right standing with God. We must choose to be right standing at all times,
amen,
knowing who we are in Christ. As you put on your socks and shoes, you are also putting on the preparation of the gospel of peace. Not only walking in God's peace everywhere you go, but also placing God's peace wherever you go. As you're brushing your hair, or for those of us who don't have hair, putting on your cap to place the helmet of salvation, which is the word salvation means to be rescued or delivered, to be saved. This helmet protects our mind, our ears, our eyes, our mouth from negative things going in and negative things coming out. The sword of the Spirit is the word of God. You must have the word of God in your heart. The Bible says in Psalms 119:11, thy word have I hid in my heart that I might not sin against thee. We must carry the word at all times. Finally, the shield of faith. Personally, this is my favorite. This shield of faith completely surrounds us. It quenches all the fiery darts from the wicked one that's thrown at us. Fear fact. When fear is present, faith is absent. Faith is a gift from God. It is the absolute belief that God is constantly working
for us in every area of our life. Wasn't this exciting? Because I was over in Indiana giving this at the same time Pastor was giving this to you last week. Who was here last week and heard this message? Okay, so therefore, there are commands in the Bible that are repeated many times. The call to stand firm is one of those. In 1 Corinthians 16:13 states, be always on the alert, stand firm in the faith. Act like men, warriors, be strong. And finally, Ephesians 6:13. Therefore, put on the full armor of God, so that when the day of evil comes, you may be able to stand your ground. And after you have done everything to stand, stand. Thank you for letting me share that. That was fun. I got a chance. Everybody stood when I said stand. Everyone in the whole church. It was great. Okay.
Are we supposed to stand?
With visible breath, I'm calling your name. With visible track, I'm finding my way. With a sorrowful heart, I honor this pain and offer these tears to the rain. In a moment of truth at the top of the hill, I'll open my arms and let go of my will and stand with nothing to wear.
Thank you.
Great job. Thank you. All right. Well, praise the Lord.
Amen.
Everybody remember this?
Yes.
Remember this?
Yes.
This stands for what?
Garbage.
Garbage.
Yes.
We have so many new folks and visitors. I want you to know that if you're not aware, yes, children, you may escape. That we're online. You can see us on, or you can tell your friends to watch us on YouTube or like us on YouTube or Facebook. And just sort of Lucerne Valley Community Church. And we should jump up so you can see all the services. We've got like 190 services online now. So you're welcome to go on there and see whatever, tell your friends. And God bless you. And if you'd like to keep supporting us from out there, we're at P.O. Box 788-923 what?
56.
Lucerne Valley, California. So God bless you, each and every one. We have God's word and we have man's word. Which one are you going to stand? Which one are you going to take?
God's word.
All right. Anybody ever had the experience of just running out of gas? Yeah?
Oh, yeah.
Ever had that again? And you hear that fatal putter, 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 and the car starts to miss, or maybe it just turns off. And you look at the needle and you say, I knew I should have checked that. Yeah. Or anybody ever run out of oxygen?
Oh, I'm still alive.
Me too.
Yeah. Everyone runs short of oxygen. Yeah. We have a problem. Oxygen is pretty important, isn't it?
Oh, yeah.
And you go up a few set of stairs at my age anymore, and the oxygen kind of sometimes wanes a little bit. Yeah. Well, you know what's really, really sad is if you run out of Oreos. And you got milk and you don't have Oreos. I mean, you're... Having supply is important, isn't it? We're going to have a lot of fun with it. But having supply of our needs is important to us. And I'm here to tell you that God has an abundant supply of whatever it is you need. I said, God has an abundant supply of whatever you need. I said, God has an abundant supply of whatever you need. In spite of what this may say, I remember years ago, some of you are old enough to remember that when Berkeley said God was dead, some of you don't remember that.
Yeah.
Well, they did that. Actually published it. God was dead. It was a big move on atheistic movements going across. I got to deal with some of those students, actually. I was at Bethany Bible University at the time, and we had a conversation going on by letter, actually going between the campuses, debating the issue of whether God was dead or not. And they taught that God was dead. That's a lie from the pit of hell.
Right.
God is not dead. And he's not broke.
Right.
I said he's not broke.
Amen.
He's not in recession.
Right.
Now I say he's not broke. That doesn't mean you shouldn't give, because you should give, because your giving is not a legalistic duty. It is an act of faith. It's an act of faith. You want to be blessed of God, you give. You sow and you shall receive. And you give God's way. So he's not broke. He's not in a recession. His stock is not down. He's not upside down on his mortgage. His business is not slipping. He's not having a Black Friday or a bad Monday. He still is God. And he has the whole world in his hands. Amen?
Amen?
He's rich in love. He's rich in forgiveness. He's rich in mercy. He's rich in patience. Everybody say, thank you, God.
Thank you, God.
How many of you think you've tried God's patience?
Oh, yeah.
How many of you are trying God's patience now? Wow. He's rich in peace. He's rich in joy. He's rich in grace. He's rich in fellowship. He loves you. Philippians 4:19 says that my God shall supply what?
All
your needs according to what?
His riches
in glory by Jesus Christ. Yeah. Everybody say, Jesus is the way.
Jesus is the way.
Psalms 50:10 says this, for every beast of the forest is mine, and the cattle of the thousand hills. And I know the birds of the mountains and the wild beasts of the field are mine. If I were hungry, I would not tell you. He doesn't need our help. We need his help. For the world is mine and all of its fullness. Psalm 24:1 says, and the earth is the Lord's and all its fullness, and the world and those who dwell therein. For he has founded it upon the seas and established it upon the waters. My God is in charge, and he holds the whole world in his hands and heaven in his hands. And if you're a child of God, you in his hands. Amen?
Amen.
He has the whole world in his hands. And he wants to bless you with an abundant life.
Yes.
I'm going to say it again because of this time and in our history that is pretty tough. Interest rates are up. We think of economics when we think of blessings a lot of times. And we think of all these different things and life is so tough. I want you to know that God loves you and he has an abundant supply to take care of all your needs. Spiritually and otherwise. But you got to do things his way. You can't do them halfway. You got to do them his way. He has a whole world in his hand, and he wants to bless you with an abundant life, abundant grace. How many can use an abundant life?
Amen.
We're going to talk about that a little bit. How about abundant grace? How much grace do you need?
Lots.
Open up the windows of heaven, huh? Yeah. How about abundant power? Abundant joy. Abundant access into his presence. We won't have time to do all of these this morning, but I want you not to leave this place to know that God loves you and he has everything you need in abundant, exceedingly abundant supply.
Amen.
And you don't have to worry. Put your faith in God.
That's right.
And serve him.
Amen.
Abundant life. Well, why did he come to earth? I come that they might have what? Life and have it what?
More abundantly.
Just enough to get by?
No.
That's not what he said. He said the thief comes to steal. The thief comes to steal. The thief comes to lie to you. The thief comes to cheat you. The world will tell you a lie. How many has ever been deceived by a salesperson?
Yeah.
I are one, I know. Sometimes what they say and what you hear are different things, huh?
Yeah.
I get the bang out of one of the commercials on TV now, and they're making fun of them about because they're selling something else, but they tell you that, yes, we can even have free TV on this flight, but we charge you for the headphones. You know the world is?
Yeah.
Deception.
Yeah.
A lie. Wow, over and over again. God's word is not that way. The very purpose for his coming, he didn't come to fence you in. Oh, our young people are sold that lie over and over and over again. He didn't come to fence you in. He came to what?
To set you free.
He didn't come to fence you in. He came to set you free. He loves you. He wants you to have life and have it more abundantly, physically and spiritually. The thief does not come except to steal and to kill and to destroy.
Joy.
I have come that they might have what?
Life.
And that they might have it more
abundantly.
He doesn't want you just to get by. He doesn't want you just to squeak through. He He wants you to have abundant life.
Abundant.
What's abundant mean?
A bunch.
A bunch?
Overflowing.
More than you need.
More than you need.
Yeah.
Wow. The Amplified Version puts it this way. And the thief comes only in order to steal and to kill and destroy. I come that they might have and enjoy life. Are you enjoying your life?
Yes. Yep.
If you were Jesus, I should be a big amen.
Amen.
And have it in abundance to the full till it overflows. He didn't want you just to squeak through. He wants you to have an abundant life.
Amen.
Wow. Again, I use the Message. I kind of liked it. I don't know, on the Message kick, all of a sudden, I usually don't use it. A thief is only there to steal and to kill and destroy. I come so that they have real and eternal life and better life than they ever dreamed of. I had not seen or has not heard, neither has it entered into the heart of man, the things which God has prepared for them that love Him. Beyond your wildest imagination, God has good for you. I am the good shepherd. The good shepherd gives his life for the sheep. Not only an abundant life here on earth, but an eternal life. The world can't give you that. Eternity. John 6:51 says, I am the living bread which comes down from heaven. If anyone eats of this bread, he will live forever. Everybody, all you Christians say, I will live forever.
Forever.
Anybody excited about that?
Yeah.
Somebody, I can read that with a straight, I will live forever. I will live forever. Do you really believe that?
Yes.
I'll believe that. I live forever. And the bread that I shall give is my flesh, which I shall give for the life of the world.
Amen.
Wow. You want abundant life?
Yes.
Come to Jesus. Come to Jesus. Beautiful young lady Wednesday night. I'm sitting back there where Lonnie's sitting right now. And the guys were singing. And they started to talk and give their verses. This is a non-believer. She rose her hand to come and say something. She came and said, you touched my heart. I feel the Lord. I haven't been in church in 7 years. I need to get right with God.
Amen.
You want life?
Praise the Lord.
You want life? That's life. And as a pastor, you get to experience that. Wow. That's better than hitting a home run in the World Series. Thank you, Lord. Because it's all about Jesus, amen?
Amen.
And the Holy Spirit. Wow. Man. Well, He doesn't stop with just life. He also gives us grace. How many are grateful for His grace?
Amen.
Abundant grace. Abundant grace. Really what it means here is no limit. Aren't you glad there's no limit? There's no topping off. There's no capping it out. There's no stopping it. It just keeps flowing from heaven. An amazing, we call it amazing grace. How sweet the sound that what?
Saved
a who?
Wretch
like me. And it doesn't stop with just salvation or just the birthing, but it what? It's perpetual. How many use this grace this morning? How many could use it right now? God loves you, and He has this abundant grace. But don't get the grace twisted. Romans chapter 6, verse 1 says, because grace abounds, then we just sin all the more. Because God wants to So God can use his grace, we'll just keep on sinning, right? No, he says, God forbid, you shouldn't be thinking like that. And the next several verses, he explains what baptism is all about. You're buried with Christ. So don't get it twisted. Don't play games with God. God has grace, and his grace is sufficient for all your needs, for all your sins. Isn't that wonderful? Isn't that amazing?
Yeah.
We say it so often in church, sometimes it just kind of like water runs off a duck's back. We don't really understand. He has enough grace to cover all your sins. Every shortcoming.
Amen.
Wow. Every misdeed. Every broken promise.
Yes, thank you.
How many have ever promised God something and you broke it? Some of you inferred, I know you can't lift your hands. But we've all used God's grace. Amen?
Amen.
Yes. Grace, favor, goodness, or kindness given without regard to worth or merit of the person receiving it.
Thank you, Jesus.
God doesn't owe you grace. He's not required to give you grace. His grace is a product of his love for you. And it comes natural to his nature to shed his grace on you because he loves you so much. Grace, favor, goodness, and kindness given without regard to worth or merit to the one who receives it. Who am I that a king should come and die for? Who are you that the Lord God Almighty would leave the splendor of heaven and come down here to a cross and die for you? Grace that is greater than all my sins. What an amazing thought.
Amen.
And as long as I'm repentant, and honestly serving the Lord, his grace never runs out. Even though my flesh may be weak and I may struggle in some areas. Of course, I know none of you have those issues. You can just pray for me. I can use a prayer and you could use a practice. Isn't that an amazing thought? That he loves you so much that he'd leave the splendor of heaven, came to earth to die for you and I. He loved you that much.
Wow.
And his grace just keeps on going. It's actually mentioned 170 times in the New Testament. We sing the song, My Cup Runneth Over. Wow. That doesn't hardly cover it. Where does all this grace come from? Ephesians 1:7 says, in him we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of sins, according to the riches of his what?
Grace.
Grace. Everybody say unmerited favor.
Grace.
You see, you're his child. All you Christians say, I'm God's child. Therefore, I have access to God's grace. God's grace. According to the riches of his grace, which he made directed towards, abound towards us in all wisdom and prudence. Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that what?
Saved
a wretch like me. I was once what?
Lost.
But now I what?
I
was blind, but
now I see.
Wow. All because of his amazing grace. Ephesians 2:4 puts it this way, but God who is rich in mercy, because of his great love with which he loved us, even when we were dead in our trespasses, If you're here right now and you don't know Jesus Christ as your personal Savior, I want you to know that God loves you as much as he loves anybody else in this building.
That's right.
Including me. And he'll never love you more. He'll never love you less. His grace is available for you also. Just as it was for me. As it was for Ralph. As it was for Edna. As it was for Bill.
Chris.
Amazing. Chris. No, Chris didn't want to get left out. Even when we were dead in our trespasses, made us alive together with Christ. You're not just alive. He hasn't just given you life, but he's given you life with who?
Christ.
Jesus Christ. That's what the Bible says. The Word of God says he hasn't just given you life. He just hasn't given you eternal life, but he's given you life with Jesus Christ. You are heirs and joint heirs with Jesus Christ. You are baptized into Jesus Christ. Your life depends now on Jesus Christ. Wow. Even when we were dead in our trespasses, made us alive together with Christ. By grace have you been saved. Oh, I talked to that young man this last week. And he was saying, Pastor, you'd be proud of me. I stopped this, I stopped that. And I am proud of him for that. That's great. And I said, well, I'm still saving you a seat in church. And he says, well, I'm working on my faith. First of all, God gives you the faith.
Yes.
You don't conjure it up. You don't get yourself ready. You come just as you are. You don't get the glory for fixing yourself. God gets the glory. You can't fix yourself. Look at the mess you made already. If you don't think it's funny, look at yourself in the mirror when you first wake up. If that doesn't bring a smile to your face. Some of us say, what happened? God loves you. And he wants for you to have life and have it more abundantly. By his grace have you been saved.
That's right.
Wow. Not of works, lest any man should boast. We could throw that in there. And raised us up together and made us sit together in heavenly places. In Christ. You understand what's going on with this grace and with this life? It's just not normal, but he's taking you to heavenly places with God. Where's Jesus now?
Right here with his Father.
And where else is he?
Right here.
Yeah,
in our hearts.
Well, heaven.
He's
Holy Spirit.
We're right here.
He's our Holy Spirit.
You want to go to glory? If you want to go to glory, pray. Mm-hmm. He's at the right hand of the Father.
Mm-hmm.
Wow. Heavenly places in Christ Jesus. Has raised us together, made us sit together in heavenly places in Christ Jesus. That in the ages to come, that he might show the what?
Exceeding riches.
How many riches?
Exceeding.
Exceeding riches. What's that mean?
Abundance.
Overflowing.
Above measurement. Beyond measurement. Exceeding riches of his what?
Grace.
How much grace has God poured out upon you during your lifetime?
Wow.
Have you ever stopped and thought about that?
Yes.
Wow.
Absolutely.
I try not to think about it. Amazing. Exceedingly riches of his grace and his kindness toward us in what? Who?
Jesus
Christ. 1 Timothy 1:14 says, and the grace of our Lord was what?
Exceedingly.
I like this phrase. What does it say? Exceedingly abundant. What do you think he's trying to tell us?
More and more and more and more. Everywhere.
You can't. Not that you should try, but you can't use it up. Amen? The devil will tell you that you're failed. That you make a mistake, that you just need to quit. You can't be perfect. Well, you can't be in your flesh. But God's grace is sufficient for your needs. Exceedingly abundant with faith and love, which are in Christ Jesus. What a strong little verse. 2 Timothy 1:9 says, "And who has saved us and called us with a holy calling, not according to our works, but according to his what?
Purpose.
Own purpose and what?
Grace.
There it is again. Grace. Which was given to us in Christ Jesus before time began." Psalms 139. He saw you when you were in your mother's womb. Wow. And you were fearfully and wonderfully made. His grace is sufficient for you. It's exceedingly and abundant. All you have to do is take advantage of it. Accept it. Say, "Thank you, Lord.
Thank you, Lord.
Forgive
thank
me. You. I'm your child."
Yes. Thank you.
Sometimes some of the theology in the past, we get this idea that we sinned, we're lost. Instantaneous backsliding, we used to call it. You make a mistake, you're done. You need to repent or else. If God comes now, you're going to go to hell. That's just bad theology.
It sure is.
It's horrible theology. And it scares people and has driven people a lot from God. I want to hear to tell you, if you've made a commitment before and you've walked away, you've gotten cold in your heart, you just need to tell God, "I'm sorry. Forgive me. My little children, I would that you sin not. But if you sin, you have an advocate with the Father, Christ Jesus the righteous, who is the propitiation, the substitute sacrifice for your sins, and not for yours only, but for your sins of the whole world." God loves you. And if you'll ask him to forgive you, he will. What do you do to get back right with God? You simply say, "Forgive me."
Amen.
You sincerely bow before him. And again, tell him that he's Lord and Master. And recommit and resubmit yourself to God. And this abundant life and this abundant grace is yours. How many like to dwell in his grace? How many thankful for his grace? How many thankful for his life? Amen. Praise the Lord. What, can I do one more? Because it doesn't stop there. His grace is sufficient for you. 1 Timothy 1:12. "And I thank Christ Jesus our Lord, who has enabled me, because he counted me faithful, putting me into the ministry. Although I was formerly a blasphemer, a persecutor, an insolent man, but I obtained mercy because I did it ignorantly in unbelief. And the grace of our Lord was exceedingly abundant, and with faith and love, which are in Christ Jesus." Paul, in spite of all that he had done, the slaughter of Christians, the battle against the New Testament church itself, probably the one who they put their robes at his feet when they stoned Stephen, God redeemed him. God forgave him. How? With his exceedingly abundant grace. And he can do the same for you. I said he can do the same for
you. Amen.
Thank you.
And he's done the same for me. Has he done the same for you?
Yes.
Wow. Father, we love you. Give you praise and give you glory. We thank you for your abundant grace. We thank you for your life that you came to give us. Not just a life of barely squeaking by, but an abundant life. Abundant supply of life. Not only life here on earth, but an eternal life. And thank you for your abundant grace Oh, your grace that covers all of our sins. Amazing grace. Exceedingly abundant grace. A fountain that never runs dry. Thank you, Lord, for loving us so much that you cover us with your grace. We just give you all the praise and all the glory. In Jesus' name, amen. Stand with me if you would. With every head bowed and every eye shut, I would just like to ask you if there's somebody here. If there's somebody here that would like to recommit themselves to the Lord. You want to know that the Lord is right, the Lord is good. You want to know you're in right standing with God. You just raise your hand and say, "Preacher, would you pray for me?" I see those hands. I see those hands also. I wonder if you'd go one step further if you'd want to. I invite you to come down here with me if you would. And we're going to pray for you. I'll meet you right down here. Anybody else would like to come? Not going to embarrass anybody, but if you'd like to come, I'd like to pray with you. We're going to move over just a little bit. Anybody else like to come? Yeah, we're going to move over this way. Okay, that's good. Anybody else? Anybody else? The Holy Spirit's working on you. Jesus said, "If you'll confess me before men, I'll confess you before the Father." If you want to recommit yourself right now, perhaps you've never made a decision for Christ, but you'd like to this morning. We invite you to come with us. Anybody else? Pray with me if you would. Just repeat after me. Jesus, I recommit myself to you. I believe you are the Christ who went to the cross for my redemption, rose again for my justification. I ask you to forgive me of all my sins, come into my heart, and be Lord and Master. And I'll live for you the rest of my life. In Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Give him a hand. In the presence, Jehovah, God Almighty, Prince of Peace. Father, we just love you. Father, we just love you. We give you praise, we give you glory. We thank these for those who have come and recommitted themselves to you. Your abundant mercy, your abundant grace. We're so thankful for it, Lord. We just give you all the praise in Jesus' name. Amen. Next week we'll go on with abundant supply, power. Anybody like abundant power?
Yes.
How about joy?
Yes. Joy. Yeah.
How about access into his presence?
Yes.
We'll talk about it next week. God bless you. See you in the back.
Yes.
Yeah. Yes, one of his. Well, it's one of his. Why is it special?
And that's how he got to be.
A little boy growing up.